Welcome aboard, folks. Pilot Mike again in my third video about the 737 Classic. In the last video, left off with the FMC pre-flight procedure. So we've gone through the electrical power-up and preliminary pre-flight and the FMS setup. Now we're going to talk about flows, these memory things that you do in the Boeing to get the airplane set up to go flying. So as usual, this is no substitute for your airline's training, but if you're a sim pilot looking to add that extra level of realism or just wanting to get familiar with the 737 Classic, this is the video for you. Please like and subscribe. All right, let's jump into it. So in the last video, we set up the FMS and did the FMS pre-flight. Usually after that is done, you do the light test, which was at the end of that last video, and then you go into review the quick reference differences and limitations card, make sure you're both on the same page, and then you talk about the emergency briefing and the departure briefing. So the pilot flying and the pilot monitoring, the captain, the first officer go through the emergency briefing and the departure briefing, and then you do the cockpit preparation flow. So this is the main subject of this video, the cockpit preparation flow, the things you do to set up the airplane for start. And then in the next video, we'll actually start it up and do the after start flows and the taxi checks and that sort of thing. All right, so first thing we do is check the oxygen and interphone. Now on this sim, it's got an old diluter demand regulator up in the corner. I would say most airplanes now have a quick donning mask. And that quick donning mask is going to be, for the first officer, it's going to be right down here. And for the captain, just on the opposite side, right down here. So if you're watching this, you're probably not a captain on a 737. So we'll kind of focus on the FO side of things. In this sim, you can actually put the armrests up and down, which is cool. And you can look around at all the controls. So with our right hand, you're going to be putting your thumb and forefinger on the oxygen mask. You don't have to take the oxygen mask out with these quick donning masks. You do this test with the oxygen mask stowed. So you're going to make sure it's properly stowed. And on the audio selector panel down here, there's the audio selector panel. Let me just move over here. We're going to select the flight interphone right here, so you know which one you have selected because the light, a light comes on. So there's VHF1, VHF2, HF1 and 2. The service interphone, when you're talking with the back, the flight interphone and the passenger address. Now, whenever you put it on passenger address, remember to flip it back to where you had it right after you're done your PA, or you're going to be reading back ATC instructions to your passengers, which is very embarrassing. So anyways, for the cockpit preparation flow, we have it on flight interphone, and we're going to select this to mask. So that is the mic selector. It puts it onto the mask so that we can check the flow of oxygen when we hit this button. This is the intercom switch, intercom or receive transmit. So we're going to actually transmit, but we're not actually transmitting to anybody except the flight interphone, which is no big deal. So you put it to mask for the microphone. It's called the mask boom switch. And then the push to talk, you momentarily push that up. But first you want to make sure that these are selected. So you push these in and it'll light up. You push it in, it lights up. You push in the speaker, it lights up. Turn up your speaker so you can hear what's going on. Not too loud. Turn up the interphone maybe to about the 1 o'clock position, and the speaker to maybe the 4 o'clock position. That's a good place to start because the speaker's right above your head. If you have it these cranked both all the way up, it's going to be really loud here. So somewhere around usually around 1 o'clock and 4 o'clock. So we've got the flight interphone selected to transmit, we've got the interphone pushed in and it lit up, and the speaker pushed in and lit up. And now we're with our right hand, we're going to start the flow of oxygen in the mask. So we make sure it's on 100%, and then we press the reset test button, and you push and hold the mask emergency test selector and observe the yellow cross in the oxygen flow indicator, and you listen for the oxygen flow sound on the flight deck speaker. So with your right hand, you're pushing the buttons there, and with your left hand, you're flipping this up to the receive transmit position like this, and you'll hear a shh. If everything's going properly, you'll hear the oxygen flowing through this mic, through the speaker, and then through the speaker. And then you release the push-to-talk switch and return the mask boom switch to boom. Boom, boom. You want them both on boom, boom, when you're done this test. And like I said, the mask can stay stowed for the entire test. You can push the buttons on the outside there. And you want to verify adequate pressure for dispatch. So once you've done this test, flip that back. You can maybe turn that off or whatever you want to do there. Select VHF1, VHF2. I might have my speaker on actually at this point to hear what's going on. And you want to verify adequate pressure. So if we go way back up to the overhead panel here, here's your oxygen pressure for the crew. You want to make sure that's adequate for dispatch. So check your manuals. You know, if it's getting below that 1,000 PSI mark, that's starting to get pretty low. But check your manuals and make sure you've got adequate pressure for dispatch as well. So the FO and the captain will do that test at the same time. So again, we go to flight interphone, mask, push that in. And with your right hand, you get the flow of oxygen going. And while the oxygen is flowing, you go up to receive transmit and you'll hear a shh in the overhead speaker. And then once you hear that, you know it's working. You go back down to boom. You set yourself up and you check the pressure. So that's the oxygen and interphone check. You want to also check the escape strap. I don't know why that would ever be gone, but here's the escape strap above the seat. It's right above the first officer's head. You push this little red button to release this panel right here. It's on a hinge. It opens up and you can see the emergency escape rope, and it's got a little ring and it's connected to a Boeing. So the joke is you check for a Boeing attached to a rope. You check your smoke goggles and sun visor. So the smoke goggles are usually living somewhere down here, along with your sun visor in a little cubby right down here. Oh yeah, you can actually see it. It's this guy right down here. There's a little cubby that you can open up with this little switch here to check the sun visor. Now, we don't use the sun visors too often because they don't work super well in the Classic. And you want to adjust the rudder pedals and check the circuit breakers that are right under the rudder pedals. So in this sim, you can indeed adjust the rudder pedals, which is amazing. So it's right down here. There's the rudder pedal adjustment knob. You can move this so that your rudder pedals move forward or back. So once you've adjusted your seat and got it in the right spot, get your rudder pedals in the right spot. And there's a line of circuit breakers right under this handle that you check as well. So that's the first thing you do in your cockpit preparation flow. And then the first officer starts their cockpit preparation flow procedure. They're going to kind of start at the top and work their way around. So let's first go up to the overhead panel here and put the IRS switches in nav, or you verify that they're in nav. So during the stand-up procedure, we already put them in nav, but we just verify nav on both the IRS and make sure the IRS lights are extinguished. All the alert lights are extinguished here. Flight control panel. So we're going to check the flight control panel, which is here on the left. I'm just going to move over here so we're kind of centered on it. Here's the flight control panel. So verify all five switch guards are down. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Make sure those are all down and that the alternate flap position is off. Yaw damp can go on. And EFIS display selectors, display source. So there should be a nav, IRS, and FMC transfer switches here. So you'll probably see a few more here. These are just going to be in the normal position on all four of them, or however many you have in your particular airplane. This one just has two. So you want to make sure they're not off to the side. You want to make sure they're in the middle on normal. That's the normal position for them. Fuel. Now moving down to the fuel panel here. So at this point, I check and see if we have any center fuel. So there's the main tanks, or the wing tanks, I should say, and there's the center fuel. So we got a ton of center fuel. So we are going to turn on the center fuel. So I kind of check that before I get here. We're going to turn, if it's just fuel in the wings, we just turn on these four. If we've got center fuel, probably going to turn these on as well. And so these are going to be our first flight flows. So we're checking a few extra things. One thing we check here is to make sure that the filter bypass lights are extinguished. So there's your filter bypass lights. And these low pressure lights here should be extinguished once you turn on the pumps. So those are the low pressure lights. They're amber lights that come on. And there's low pressure. See, when I have it off, you can see it. When I turn the pump on, that light should go out. And we're going to check the crossfeed function. So turn this over the side. It should go bright blue and then dim, just like that. Wow, great sim. Really accurately simulates the systems in a Classic. And then back the other way, it goes bright, indicating the valve is moving, and then out, indicating it agrees with the position of the switch here. So there's the fuel panel, electrical panel. We've got the AC selector on APU Gen right now, and the DC selector on BAT. So we should have good voltage there, and the APU Gen should be putting out its around 400 hertz and around 115 or so volts. And you make sure the standby power is in auto, and these generator drive disconnects, these CSDs or whatever you want to call them, the generator drive, you want to make sure they're safety. These are actually going to be safety wired so that you can't accidentally open them up and disconnect it, because once you do that, it's game over. You can only reset that on the ground. So these are actually lock wired, so when you do open them and disconnect the CSD, it's not accidental. So make sure those are down, and they should be safety wired. The drive temp, we usually have that on in, so we make sure that's on in. It has to do with the CSD here, the generator drive oil temperature. You can either do a rise or in, but we usually have it on the in setting. Bus transfer switch in auto. So moving down here, there's our bus transfer switch. We just make sure it's in auto. So if it's guarded, it's in auto. See, there's the auto side. You have to lift up the guard to put it in off because the normal position would be auto. And check the TRs. So while we were going by here, we can check the TRs 1, 2, and 3. So the normal range, I think, is 5 to 15 volts just off the top of my head. 5 to 15 amps on the DC amp meter here. So this is the DC side. This is the AC side. If you forget, it says it right down here, AC and DC. It's a little hard to see with that guard in the way, but that says DC and AC. So we check the TR1, TR2, TR3 between 5 and 15. Of course, consult your manual for that. And it usually lives in the 3 position. We'll just leave it on 3. So we kind of jumped around a little bit there. And equipment cooling. We make sure that's in normal and that the equipment cooling off light is extinguished. Passenger signs, if we're done fueling, we're going to switch the no smoking and seatbelt signs on. Window heat is going to go on at this point. So let me just move over here. Window heat goes on. You probably see these 4 lights come on. If they don't come on, it might mean that the window is hot. So if the window's hot, you might not get the green light, but you also want to make sure the window overheat lights aren't on. So like I said, in high ambient temperatures, you might not get the green on light. And the pitot static, there's a new mod. This should be auto or on. So auto is there to save your butt if you take off with it in the what used to be the off position like it is here. So there's auto and on. You just want to make sure these are auto. If you turn them on, they'll turn on the ground and all these lights go out. But so for now, we're just having it in auto position. After start, we'll turn these to the down position in our after start flows. But right now, they're just in auto. With the window heat, you want to position the switches on at least 10 minutes before takeoff. Give it some time to warm up. And moving down to the anti-ice, wing anti-ice, off. Verify that the valve open light right here is extinguished. Engine anti-ice, off. Verify that the cowl anti-ice lights are extinguished and that the cowl valve open lights are extinguished. So there's a set of blue lights here and there's a set of amber lights. Those should all be extinguished. Hydraulics set and normal. So engine 1A on, the electric off. B electric, the B electric might be on. If there's gusty, windy conditions, we'd have the B elec on. If it's not gusty and windy, we could have it off. The B-Elec is for the flight controls, so that'll hold the rudder and keep it from flapping around in the wind. So let's say it's not windy, so we have the B-Elec off, and the B engine-driven pump couldn't be in the on position. The engines aren't on right now, so this engine 1 and engine 2 in B, these pumps won't run until the engine is spinning. If we do use that B pump, we can check the pressure. We want 2800 min PSI, and there's a hydraulic brake pressure right here, and then there's the hydraulic B system pressure down here. So you can see the hydraulic brake pressure is about 3200 PSI, and down here, the hydraulic B system pressure is around 2900 here, and you can see the A is depressurized, it's down at 0. Okay, so we've set the hydraulic panel. Now we move on to the air conditioning panel. So you select the air temperature as needed. These switches, this is in the manual position right now. It's pointing down on the manual position. They're usually in auto. So you usually see them in the auto position. Somewhere around the 12 o'clock position is a good place to start. Verify that the duct overheat lights are extinguished. That's the dual bleed light. There's the outflow valve closed. The duct overheat is right here and right here. And this will show you the position of the mix valve for each side. And you can select the temperature either for the supply duct or in the passenger cabin. I usually use supply duct. Recirc fan goes to auto. And with the 300s, we'll use the right pack switch here in auto. Isolation valve auto. Left pack off. Engine bleeder switches on. So there's the left number 1 engine bleeder switch. There's the number 2 engine bleeder switch. There's the APU bleed switch. So that's on right now. So with the pack on and the APU bleed on, this is going to supply, you know, warm or cool air back to the control cabin and the passenger cabin with that isolation valve. But you want the passengers to have heat if it's cold, or some cooling if it's warm. And you set the temperature with these knobs here in the auto position. You can go to manual. I don't use it very often, but you go straight down and then just select cool. You hold it in the cool position for a moment and you can see the mixer valve moving. And then that's, I believe it's spring loaded back to the off positions. And either go cool or warm. But normally auto, 12 o'clock, somewhere around 11, 12 o'clock. It's where I'd start out. And here you want to verify that the dual bleed light's extinguished. This is the dual bleed light here. This happens, you know, if the engines are running, if you fire up the engines and you forget to turn off the APU bleed, you'll get a dual bleed light. So the limitation there is you can't do anything more than idle power with the dual bleed light on. So make sure that's not on. Verify that the pack trip off lights are extinguished. So there's pack trip off for each side. There's wing body overheat and the bleed trip off for each side. Make sure those are extinguished right here. You can reset them with this button. And that happens sometimes if you get a condition where the pack trip off triggers and you want to reset it, you can reset it with this button here as per your non-normal checklist, of course. Pressurization panel. So this is the old school pressurization panel. You might see this in an older simulator. The newer ones will have a digital, but it's similar. You want to verify that the lights here are extinguished. You've got the auto fail light, the off-schedule descent light, the standby light, and the manual light. So verify these are all extinguished because this should be in auto mode now. There's the auto mode. You can select standby and then the green standby light comes on. And then there's some other modes here, manual mode. But you probably won't have this pressurization selector. What you'll have is the digital one where you set your cruise altitude in the window. You set your landing altitude in this other window. And this has a flight ground switch, which is you don't see on the digital panel. So on the digital panel, you'll have it cruise, landing altitude. You'll have it in auto. And that's pretty much it for the digital pressurization panel. Engine start switches. So moving across the bottom here, this would normally be in the steady position. That's your nav lights. And now engine start switches, make sure these are off. You can see ignition is off and not clicking away. And position this, you can have on the left igniters, the right igniters, or both. Normally you just put it to the side of the pilot flying for the leg. So say if the right seat person was flying, you'd put it to the right side. If the captain was flying, you'd put it to the left side. Now if it's cold, if you're above 2,000 feet and it's below 5 degrees Celsius, consider putting it in the both position. And that might increase the likelihood of a successful start on the first attempt. And we went past the exterior lights and we set those as desired. And then we're down to the mode control panel. There's the mode control panel. So we're still doing the FO close. We set the mode control panel. I just have it set to 275 for runway 27 here in San Diego. And moving over to the flight instruments, set the altimeter and the reference marker. So set your altimeter to whatever you got there. And if this is the bug, that's like an altitude bug. So set that to your minimum flap retraction bug or minimum flap retraction altitude, MFRA. And that's usually, let's say in this case, it's 1,000 feet. So that with this kind of older style of altimeter, we are setting it to 1,000 feet, which is, say if we're at 50 feet, there's 1,050. So let's say if we were up at 200 feet AGL here, or ASL, say our airport elevation is 200 feet, 1,200 feet would look like this on the MFRA. So that takes a little getting used to, because in here it says the altitude on the outer knob. There's only 0 through 9. So San Diego's pretty close to sea level here. We'll set it to whatever we had it at. And the MFRA bug, or altitude bug, is going to go to 1,000 feet above the field elevation right there. So you just verify that the flight instrument indications are correct. You should only get a certain flags here, like the TCAS off. That's normal to see. Expected RDMI flags, and verify that the flight mode annunciators are correct. The auto throttle mode should be blank, roll mode blank, pitch mode blank, and the AFD status is FD. So there's no FD status here at the moment, but we'll work our way through that. And make sure you're in the map mode. So if something's wrong here, we've got an HSI mode. Normally we'd use a map mode. So you can see one thing is not like the other. The left side's in the map mode, this side's in like an HSI mode. So that's done on the panel right down here. So we'll set that to map mode. It was on center map. So we'd have this in map mode. Also have this to minus 200 or minus 20. And probably have the range down at 20. And I like to have the airports on there. So that side's correct. Minus 20 map. And we'll go to 20 mile range. And first flight of the day, we do the EGPWS test down here. Ground proximity warning. Let's see if this works here. Oh, it does. Pull up. Wind shear. Wind shear. Wind shear. Terrain. Pull up. Oh, very cool. So it actually goes through the full test there. Oh, when you release it, it stops. In the real airplane, if you release it, it keeps going. You just hold it a few seconds to do the full test. And moving here, I'd probably have ADF. Don't usually use VOR too much. And I have a quick look at the hydraulic brake pressure. We're going to set this to RTO. And it goes through its little test here, and then that light should extinguish. Let's see if the sim does it. Make sure this guard is closed. We want the anti-skid to always be on. So it doesn't look like this is going to go out on the sim, but this light should go out when you turn the selector to RTO. That's rejected takeoff. So that's the setting used for takeoff. All right, so we've set the auto brake to RTO. We're going to come over and make our way through the engine gauges. N1 manual set knob. Make sure that's pushed in. That way these bugs will be set automatically by the FMC. If it's pulled out, you can set it manually, and then you get it in the manual set window here. See the side we set to, see how it moves the bug. So that's all that knob does. When you pull it out, you can manually set the N1 target. But normally it's done automatically by the FMC. So make sure that's pushed in. Right here is the fuel used reset button. So we reset the fuel used. You hold that down until it zeroes out on the fuel gauges here. And then engine instruments. Verify that the primary and secondary engine indications are looking good and that there's no exceedances or anything weird. So this should be zero EGT. Got normal kind of pretty close to OAT. You know, if you're doing a quick turn, these are going to be up a bit into zero, fuel flow zero, because the engines aren't running. There's no oil pressure. There's the TAT in degrees Celsius, oil temperature. This is the oil quantity in percent full. So right now it's 100% full on the left and the right side. It's the engine vibration. Engines aren't running, so they're at zero. Here's hydraulic A and hydraulic B. So hydraulic A pressure is zero, which is normal. Hydraulic B, I turned on the B pump, and it's around 2,800 PSI. And here's the hydraulic quantity of each reservoir for A and B. So 97 and 99. And it says RF 88%, so you refill it at 88%. So if it's below 88%, gotta get it refilled. Okay, so we've made our way down here. We're going to make our way down. That should be in test. Testing all the way cranked up is probably the safest place to be. And we make our way down to the panel here. If there's a cargo fire detection, first flight of the day, we check that. Radios, you can set those up 1, 2, and maybe a 3 if you have it. I have the active radio frequencies indicated by the light. So if I transfer this over, that one's now active. If I transfer that over, it's now active. Sometimes you'll see numbers for VHF 1 and a 2 for 2 and a 3 for 3. Otherwise, you can kind of assume this is VHF 1 right here. If you want to transmit on this one, this is VHF 2. If you want to transmit on 1 and listen to 2 also, have this pushed in and the volume turned up to your liking, like so. First flight of the day, we also do the TCAS test. So I think the sim does the TCAS test. What we want to see is it running through its self-test, but also on the displays here, we want to see the traffic symbology. Let's try that. Let's put it to test. Okay, there it is. There's the traffic symbology. And it should say TCAS test passed. So if you don't see the traffic symbology here, it's because you've got this button right here to push the traffic switch. So if I push this little knob that's on the top of each one of these, it turns the traffic display on and off. See it? There it is right there. I changed the map. Let's zoom right in on the map mode so you can see that a little bit better. If I hit this traffic button, see the traffic disappears right up here. So there's no traffic. I push that traffic button on top of the map range selector, and the traffic reappears. So that's the TCAS test right there. You listen for it to say TCAS test, okay. And you make sure that these buttons are selected so you get traffic on your display. And here on the EFIS control panel, we're going to make sure this is all set up. Decision height selector, we just dial that down to minus 20. Mode selector should be on map. Range selector as needed. 10 or 20 are the usual values. I'm going to select 20 on each side. Traffic switch selected on. Weather terrain switch selected on. So you select those guys on. FO will do their side. Captain will do their side. And you make sure that the terrain switch is selected on your forward panel here. So right now it's showing the weather radar test pattern. There should be a switch around here somewhere. I don't think it's on the sim, but there'll be a little terrain button. You press terrain or weather radar, there'll be two switches, and you want it in terrain. And map switches as needed. Like I said, I usually put the airport on. That'll show nearby airports along the route on your display there. You can also select the route data, waypoints, nav aids, VORs, and ADFs. There's the brightness knob here. And there's a brightness knob here for the EHSI, and this one's for the EADI. Audio control panel, this takes a little getting used to. It's an old school audio control panel. So the light is what you're transmitting on, and whatever's lit up here is what you have selected to listen to. You'll always be able to listen to the one that you're transmitting on. That happens automatically. But if you wanted to listen to VHF 2 without it being selected here, you have to push in this and adjust the volume. So if I wanted to listen on VHF 1 and 2, no matter what, I'd push those in so they light up. I have the volume somewhere around the 12 or 1 o'clock position. Right now I have the speaker on. I'm just going to turn the speaker off right now because I'm going to be putting on our headsets shortly. And I want to hear the flight interphone. Maybe the service interphone too, to hear what the flight attendants are up to or hear what passenger announcements are going on. And I'll put the flight interphone on so I can hear the ground crew. ADF radios, tune those to whatever you want in 1 and 2. And make sure it's in the ADF if you want it to be working on both sides. And I had previously put my RMI here to ADF, ADF instead of VOR, VOR. And transponder panel. So we did the test of the transponder panel. Normally we'd set this, it'll be an ATC 1 or 2. And a transponder 1 or 2, can cycle those based on the pilot flying. We can have 1 for the captain and 2 for the FO flying if you want to test each encoder and transponder. This has a TCAS range and above normal and below. So that's on the newer classics, that's going to be automatic. You're not going to be able to adjust the TCAS range or put it in above normal or below. And there's the ident button right there. And then a little bit different terminology from other airplanes here. They've got standby, alt off, alt on, TA, and TARA. So traffic advisory, resolution advisory. So the normal position for flight would be TARA. There's just a little notch showing which mode it's in. It's even hard to see on the plane too sometimes, especially in the dark. You might have to shed a little light on there or have the lights turned up. So normally on the ground, it'd be on standby. Some airports, you'll have it on alt on. That'll be done in the after start flows that we'll look at next. And last but not least, the stabilizer trim guard. So override and normal. You just want to make sure that guard is down so it's in the normal position. And you adjust your seat and rudder pedals, and off you go. And so the captain does a flow now. They've already tested the oxygen and interphone. So now the captain goes to the mode control panel and sets that. So sets the course. The flight director switch goes to on. So these are the flight director switches here and here. I'll just zoom in a little here. So course set, flight director switch on. If the FO is flying, you turn on the FO side first, and then the captain side. And see, we get that FMA enunciation flight director. And you can see there's a light on here that indicates that that's the master flight director. If the captain was flying, you turn on the left side first, and then the right side, and the left side would be the master. So we'll say the FO is flying this time. We turn that flight director on, and then that flight director on. Heading selector, set that to whatever you need for the departure. There's a bank angle selector here. You can select what bank angle the autopilot's going to target when it's turning. So 30, I'd say, is, you know, pretty normal. If you got an engine failure scenario or something where you'd want to have a more shallow bank, you can adjust that bank angle selector to whatever you want. And 10 through 30 there. The altitude selector, set that for your SID if you've got a clearance. So we're pretending that this SID is up to 5,000 feet, so that's been set in the window. And autopilot disengage switch should be up. The bar should be up as installed. And then they go down to their panel here and check the clock and check the nose wheel steering guard and make sure that guard is down here. The ADF, ADF. Verify that the stab out of trim light is extinguished. So the stab out of trim light is over here. And then flight instruments. You're going to set the altimeter and the reference bug. Verify that the flight instrument indications are correct. And that you've only got the TCAS off flag, expected RDMI flags. Pitch mode, roll mode is blank. And the AFD status is FD. So that came on once we turned on the flight directors. And standby horizon. So there's a standby gyro right here. You want to make sure that's erect by pulling it out. Verify the proper attitude and that the approach mode selector is off. And standby altimeter, you'd set that as well. So you got 2 altimeters to set. Speed brake lever down. Now moving down to the pedestal here. Speed brake lever down. All the way forward is down. Verify that the speed brake arm light is extinguished over here and here. And the speed brake do not arm light is extinguished. And the speed brake extended light is extinguished. Reverse thrust levers seems like a no-brainer, but you want to make sure that the reverse thrust levers are down and that the thrust levers are closed. You don't want them way up. Oh, you can hear the takeoff config warning. That's the takeoff config warning going. Oh, they were up a little bit. So if somebody bumped them or if maintenance was messing around, these might not be all the way back. So you want to make sure the thrust levers are all the way closed. Flap levers set should be up and agreeing with the position indicated on the flap indicator right here. So those are showing up. And the lever is showing up as well. All the way forward is up. And you should see it in that zero knots. There's a 0, 1, So here, 2 and 5, and then 10, 15, 25, 30, 40. Parking brake set. So the parking brake should be in this vertical position with the light on, indicating that it is set. And verify that the pressure is above 1,000 PSI. So there's the hydraulic brake pressure reservoir there. 1,000 is the pre-charge on this one. So when it says at 1,000, it's like dead. Start levers cut off. You want to make sure those are at cutoff. If maintenance was messing around with this and they're up like this and you go to start the aircraft, you might have a hung start or a hot start. It's bad news. So you want to make sure those are in cutoff. It cuts off the fuel to the number one and number two engine. Stabilizer trim cutout switches right here on the pedestal. You want to make sure those guards are closed and that they're in the normal position. There's normal and cutout. You can only get to cutout by lifting the guard and putting the switch down like so. That's the stab trim. Main elect cutout and autopilot cutout. So we normally have these guards closed and they're up in the normal position. Rudder and aileron trim. So the rudder and aileron trim down here. There's the rudder and aileron trim. This should move the column left and right. You can see the column moving to the left. You can see the column moving to the right. And you put that back in the zero position. So the aileron position is indicated right here. This white line is showing you how much aileron trim there is left or right. So you can see it's a little to the left. So I didn't quite center it properly. So I'll try and go back and do that. Kind of toughen the sim. There we go. So we put it back to zero. And the rudder trim as well. So there's the rudder trim. It's spring-loaded back to the center position. So rudder pedals. Adjust the rudder pedals to allow full rudder pedal and brake pedal movement. And check each trim for freedom of movement and then set to zero. So there's the rudder trim position indicator right here. Actually, you're not going to see the pedals move. Okay, so there's the aileron trim. There's the rudder trim. Check that for freedom of movement each side and then put it back to zero. Spring loaded back to the center position. Then you adjust your seat and your rudder pedals, seatbelt and shoulder harness, and then off you go. Then this is where the captain's going to call for the before start checklist to the line. All right, thanks for joining me. Be sure to like and subscribe. In the next video, we'll be going through the before start checklist and then the flows that happen after you start the aircraft. After start flows and the after start checklist. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.